And what, like I always say, when you're teaching about the armor of God, a lot of times people are like, oh, there's a lot of people that are into it because they're like people that love, you know, like medieval stuff. And they love to talk about, you know, medieval stuff. And they're really into like literally wearing armor. And they go to those reenactment things and all that. There's nothing wrong, you know, nothing wrong with imagination. But myself, you know, I was in the military and all that. But there are people that are into that stuff. I'm not. I'm not into living in an imaginary world. I'm into the practicality and, you know, the practical application of the armor of God. Not talking about, you know, in kind of some kind of an abstract theoretical way. Because even though when we're sitting here, there's lots of people who are pristinely unanointed Christians, pristinely unspiritual Christians who cannot think outside, you know, A plus B is C. They can't think in a spiritual way, not an imaginative way, but I mean, that's one way you could describe it, you know, as an imaginative way. Circular logic is the term that's used, circular logic, in other places besides the West. And the Bible, Hebrew, follows that same pattern of, you know, this parables and all those things where you see when people have dreams, when they have visions and all that. A lot of times, especially dreams, are parables. And you have this, the word parable, para, like a paramedic, a paralegal in English, it means alongside of, like a paramedic literally means alongside of a doctor, a paralegal, alongside of a lawyer. So para is alongside of, and a bala is to throw, like the English word ball. One of the first words you learn as a little kid, ball. So to throw alongside is what parable means. It's a comparative. It's a shadow. It's an abstract way of looking at something that's concrete. So the Lord is really leading me to say this. I never thought about it this way. Is this what you need to do? Because, you know, my ministry is a spiritual sided ministry, even though we talk about lots of Bible verses, but looking at the spiritual greater things in a higher dimension, you might want to say, in the natural world. And so I run into lots of people, lots of you guys come from, are kind of on the intellectual side, or, you know, on the side of all these old mainline denominations, all the way through Baptist. And without the, you know, the Pentecostal people, usually you're going to get more spiritually minded people. Sometimes they're not rooted and grounded in the word. And that's the pitfall on the charismatic side of the church. On the other side of the church, which is at least half the church, pristinely unanointed, pristinely operating only in the intellect of their mind and not being able to comprehend in their spirit man. See, because just even like getting saved, it says to believe with the heart and confess with your mouth. Romans chapter 10, verse 9 and 10. If you believe in your heart and confess with your mouth. So we're talking about believing in the heart, not in your mind. The mind is one part. You know, first, you know, you renew your mind with the word of God, bring every vain imagination into captivity to the word of God. And then you get healed, you get saved, you get answered prayer when you believe in with the heart or the spirit man. You know, the King James uses the word heart, but not your literal, for all those same pristinely unanointed people. We're not talking about your literal beating heart. We're talking about your spirit. That's your spirit man. We are a body, a soul, and a spirit. Your soul is your mind, your id, as they say, your consciousness, and then your spirit man is where God speaks to us. The Bible says the spirit of a man is a candle of the Lord. So, brothers and sisters, we have to believe in our heart and receive those things of God. Add another great point.